Okay.
I can't think of the examples off the top of my head, but you talk about that, how just a word that for us, I mean, it's very common. You even call it reach still because that's what all coaches call it. Mm-hmm. But in a kid's brain, there is just something. And I'm a gym teacher. This is what I say all the time. I don't know this, but someone way smarter than me can tell you about it. There just isn't a connection, or maybe you cannot disconnect what reach may look like and what they think of. And I feel like it was a basketball example, but like I said, I can't think of it off the top of my head, but you just have to retrain yourself on the words you use. And it's the same thing, honestly, in PE class with the kids. If you say something that means, you know, something very similar, very common to you, but it's just not relating to them, you know, like you said, you can't retrain their brain. You right. can't retrain 150 of their brains. It's, you know, you have to figure out what they relate to and change your vernacular.
Yeah, which is certainly easier than trying to reteach kids a language. Language is powerful and you have to be very aware of it, which, you know, as I do all this, I think it shows how much time we coaches put into and how much thought we put into this stuff, right? And it's really just an incredibly fun hobby. And
almost
that's why
no one knows
it
or appreciates it except yeah. for the coaches, right?
Unless you sit down and listen to a guy talk about one play for an hour, which I'm doing here, and that's when you start to realize, oh my gosh, people have spent way too much time thinking about this. Well, mm-hmm. If I talk about – so that was the idea of race. We're going to work that desire drill, and we're going to either do desire drill or a POA every day. So POA is point of attack. So I'll go to that last part here, point of attack. And I'll just get a new layer here.
Now you talked about the little wide receiver just running down and blocking another little wide receiver. I don't know if this is where you're going point of attack, but like, you know, for me, what I grew up with the wing tee, it was basically the backside, you're heading to the point of attack. And what I love telling kids, like my tackles usually, is you get to go pick on someone half your size. You know, you go over there and you pick on that little bitty guy. And, you know, I always enjoy doing that, you know, kind of relating to the young person brain, how much fun that would be to be the big tackle and go pick on some little dude. But when I think point of attack, that's what I think. But, you know, you might be going a different direction.
Well, I mean, it's along those lines, certainly. Well, for us, when we say our point of attacks, it's like a segment of practice. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And our POAs are where we work on. So if you have any one play, right? So I'm just going to draw a generic line. And in this play, you're attacking right here, that's the point of attack. So we're gonna, and that's the most important part of your attack, right? Whoever's playing over here, honestly, they're less important on that play. And this is what it is, they're less right. important. We're attacking here, whatever you do is less important, right? You could do a somersault, I don't care what you do, but we're obviously going to be more exact, but it's irrelevant. We need to practice this, and we need to practice a lot. So we're going to work on our point of attacks. It's a segment of practice. We'll call out which play we're working. And the kids know how to do our point of attacks during that play, right? So in our rocket POAs, coach is in the middle. We've got a group of kids here. We've got a center. We usually do it without our center and guard. We'll have a quarterback kind of snap it to the other quarterback, but I'm going to draw those guys in. I'll have a quarterback. I will usually I'll have a wing back to run it to, and I'll have a tackle. A tight end, my wing. I should draw him in a different place. Oops. And an X, right? So we're going to work with this outer edge here. We're going to run a rocket. And then I have another group over here. Now I might have my tackle over group over here running rocket and a Z, an F, and a Z. We're running rocket this way, right? And I got an X. And I've got some kids out here at the edge. The guys that I need to get blocked. So what we're going to do is we're going to come here and we're looking at this and I'm looking right here. I've got a position coach right here and a position coach right here. So I'm here in the middle and I go, okay, right side, here we go. Quarterback, all these personnel step up, ready, race it, go. Boom, here we come and we're blocking this. This is our race, right? So this is race skate. Race skate says your job, Z, is to block the race, the first man outside of you. Until one of your teammates crosses your face, then you look outside of him and you're looking to kick a guy outward. Okay, that's the skate, race skate, right? We'll try to get our tight end outside this X as well, which we will a lot. We'll get two guys out there, which is why we love running. Well, that's that plus one advantage. Okay. If no one crosses your face, then you're going to block that last guy, right? So in when this play starts right here, my Z and my Y are both looking at this outside linebacker ready to block him. They're both thinking I'm racing him. They won't both, but they both have to be prepared to. Then their buddy crosses their face. They're both looking outside. Okay, so we get good at that because, again, we're spending 7 minutes a day. So it goes like this. Ready, race, set, go. Boom. I yell out one thing, whatever I want to coach up. And then I turn my direction this way right away. So like within 4 seconds. Mm-hmm. Over here on the left. When I turn to the left, these guys know they're supposed to be ready. Like when they're literally, their cue is I look over. When I look at them, the quarterback gets under center, and right, everyone's like, get set. Like his quarterback's job is to tell him to get set. Say, get set, ready, race, set, go. And now while I'm over here, this coach here is now working with these guys to get them the next guys. If I got guys to rotate through, get set. We're getting ready to go. Okay. Or he's helping to reinforce the coaching point that I pointed out or anything that he saw as well. Right. I mean, he's free to coach, but he has to have them ready by the time I get back. Right. Mm-hmm. So he's got whatever you can get done in that time, get it done. And so we're going to go back and forth and we're going to do this for 7 straight minutes. Right. And then we're going to work. We usually do POAs for 2 periods, which is 2 7-minute periods. So we're on, if it's a day where we're not working rocket POAs, then we're going to do our desire drill for 7. If it's a day where we did desire drill, we're probably going to work 2 different POAs during that day. Right. We might work our belly POA, our mm-hmm. buck sweep POA. Right. So our POAs are our point of attack period. We're going to rep this period point of attack. Right. I told you we're going to minimum rep this rep. We're going to minimum rep rocket 7 minutes a day, which really it's more than that because we'll run it at least twice during team. And then we're going to run it several times during frames, which is why you're always going to get 7 out of one of these two. And then you're going to get 3 more out of this. And right. So it's 10 minutes a day rep and rocket. So it's every day committed to it and regular. And we never stop. We never stop. And so what happens is we get good at this. We show them different looks, different possibilities, because you can't predict what you're going to see. Right? You have some ideas, but you can't predict what you're going to see. But we get good at blocking this. And we get good at blocking it because we do it all the time. Mm-hmm. So going on to number 4, and as I transition here into point number 4, any comments? And this is the last one.
Okay. Question. Where does the term skate come from? Like the whole race thing makes sense to me. I can draw the connection. Now I know what skate is, but where does the name come from?
So that one was just a term that was stolen from a guy named Gordon Elliott out in Auburn, Washington. He's a seasoned coach who's had a ton of success. And it was just the term he was using, race skate, skate meaning move on, float to the next man. And somehow he came across skate. And so we just took it. You know, I couldn't think of a better word. And so the kids latched onto skate. So skate is kind of like a flexible thing. For the most part, it's move on to the next man outside over inside. Mm-hmm. And so we wanted one word that meant all that.
Got it.
So that was skate for us. And so what happened was, and if I go back to the idea of blocking rocket, when it comes to blocking rocket, which obviously to block rocket is very important. You have to block it well to be good at it. We came down to this idea. We always want our tight end over, not always, but for the most part, right? What we determined was these are the two guys that can make the play. It's your free safety or your inside linebacker, okay? Not this guy even, because we're going to block, we're going to go this way with this man, and we're usually going to step this way with this man, okay? Once in a while, we do actually bring this guy this way a lot, but if we know you're reading our guards, then he's going to go this way. If you're not reading our guards, we're reading our fullback, then they're both going this way, right? And that's to hold this guy backside. He has to. So now front side, you're race skating. This guy's coming down to this man. We're getting this guy outside of it to your corner. This guy's a bonus man. And you got to decide which of these two you're trying to take this play away with. If you decided you're trying to take this play away with this guy, well, that's where our next play, complement play, where we'll get him behind you and stretch vertically. If you decide you're trying to take away with this man, that's where we're going to come and we're going to hit you with belly inside of it to our fullback, right? And so when we run rocket, we're watching how are you trying to stop it with this man or this man?
Okay. And you got a dude upstairs watching that, or is that you?
Like, yeah, oh yeah. That's what we're watching religiously. Okay. So when we block, we don't even think about blocking these two really. If we get them, they're a plus. We do have our guard is trying to get to this man, but we're not counting on it. That's a bonus. Okay. We're assuming they're not blocked. We're gonna block this man, the D end, and the corner. Those are the guys we want to get blocked, and the rest we want to hold accountable with the rest of the things in our playbook and watch who's making the play. Right. And that's where, and so that's how we're trying to get good at it. So if I move on to blocking this, that was it. I want to show you. So let's move on to number four, because otherwise this will be the longest podcast of you guys' life. I talk too much.
No, not at all. Okay.
So the commitment part is the last part. So I've given details, you know, how we do it. Obviously there's more details I could coach and people, I've had guys that have wanted to talk more details with me, but when it comes to summing this up, how we gotten good at Rocket, we committed to it. We spend, and I spend, an unreasonable amount of time. So, you know, they talk about Dan Gable, who's the most storied American wrestler of all time. He said, I did things that people labeled me as a madman, but I see nothing wrong with spending a lot of time on something, you know, that something you want to be really good at, that other people won't understand it, right? And so I, as the head coach, have coaches in my ear wanting to spend less time on it. I have families or parents or whoever that think that want to spend less time on it, and the kids are tired of it and they feel like they know it. We spend an unreasonable amount of time on it. And I say unreasonable because I want it to sound, I want people to realize that it's not like this comfortable amount of time. It's a lot of time. You want to do something else, but you don't. You do this. We keep working on it. The second thing is adversity. And adversity comes down to what about when you run it for the first time in a game and it goes for -2, or your kid drops it, or it's not hitting the way you want it to, or you're not blocking it as well as you want it to, or you're 0-2. All these things are adversity, and they're going to happen. Will you still stick with it then? Right? Because the reality is going to it and sticking to we major in Rocket is not a one-game commitment. It's a you're saying, I'm going to commit to this. Are you willing to commit to it when you're 0-2? That's the hard thing. What about when you're 0-4? What about when you're 0-6? So you have to say, can I commit to this through adversity? What about when Superstar got hurt? What about, so the what ifs are, they continue, that's coaching. And that's the hard part of coaching, is because common sense, remember this word, you will find 50 good reasons to commit to something else. They're not bad reasons, they're good reasons. People have, and you're looking at it logically going, I have good reasons to stop majoring in this. I have good reasons to practice something else during my 7 minutes, because something will pull. So this is a huge piece of the puzzle. And this is where I think accountability comes in. And this is where your staff comes in accountable. I would love to sit here and tell you that that was always the guy that said, no, darn it, this is what we're committing to. But the reality is there were times where I wanted to switch. And I had an assistant coach that reminded me, Nate, you said this was going to happen in May. I'm just reminding you. And I'm like, dang it. You're right. So this will come up, and you'll have good reasons to switch. And this could come whatever you've decided your major was going to be. Okay, so this isn't about Rocket. This is, do you want to major in this or not? Right? Okay, so the last thing is boredom. And this isn't about kids. This is about you. This is about you, okay? And as a football coach, you get tired of driving the same fancy car. In fact, your fancy car has turned into an old dud car. Your truck is a 1987 Chevy now called Rocket. And everyone hates it, and some of the pretty girls don't like it, and your parents don't like it, but it's called Rocket, and it's your truck. You want a new truck. There are new trucks out there. You want to do other plays. I love Buck Sweep. I love this fancy new thing off Buck Sweep. I love Trap. I love... And I get bored. So now in 2015, maybe I focused in this and on this. And now 2016, I'm kind of bored of focusing on that. I really want to do something else because it's fun. Or That's the thing you have to fight. Do you want to be great at Rocket? If you stop, and this is true, if you stop majoring in Rocket, you will no longer be great at Rocket. I want to make sure that is clear. Okay? It doesn't mean you won't be good at football anymore. Okay? Just be aware. Just make sure you're aware if you've changed your major. Because it wasn't like, hey, we were really good at it this year. Next year, we won't have to spend 7 minutes a day on it. Nope. You will. Mm-hmm. Like the coaches that say, I'm tired of coaching effort. I shouldn't have to. My contention is always, you have to. Effort is universal. Your ability to coach effort is what separates you from other coaches. You coach humans. So you have to coach effort. So if you change your major, you will no longer be good at what you used to major in. Right? I wish it was like normal thing, because here, what changes every year as a coach?
Your this players.
Yes. But your little circles that on your piece of paper look the same as it did last year, right? I get it. When you draw that up on paper, that circle looks the same as it did in 2010. But you know what's not the same? The person that's filling the shoes of this circle. Mm-hmm. That's why it never ends. It never ends. And you as a person, as a coach, you will get bored. And I got bored. And that has been some of my downfall. And I learned that lesson the hard way. I got bored. And so we didn't focus as much, right? And that was my attention getter. Hey, whoa, I had to learn that hard way and lose some games. Now, after those lessons, I realized your major must stay your major, must stay your major if you want to keep doing that, be good at that major. And I do see a lot of value in not changing majors every year. So there's my my way too long thing on being good at something. And for us, that was how we got good at Rocket.
Got it. So in the complimentary plays, I did want to ask you about that. You had mentioned belly is one of them, right? And then your passing off of it to keep the defensive back or that outside linebacker accountable. Those are sort of the plays that you will go off of Rocket. Is that accurate? Yeah.
Our complimentary plays are, of course, belly, which for us is the wing tee people call down. It's down, down pull. So we're going to run for us belly. We're going to run our best pass play off. It was called crack seam, where we fake that crack block and we go mm-hmm. vertical. And then, of course, you don't forget about reverse, which is where that X receiver comes around the whole mm-hmm. backside, because that's what holds that back, even if you run it one every three games. And if I could go back and do it again, I would run reverse more because it holds that backside accountable. So
sure.
Those are our complementary plays. Now, the one we use the most, belly. You know, it was like 50-50 Rocket belly. Mm-hmm. And then try to stretch you vertical and make you hold you accountable to crack seam, because that's your home run play.
All right.
I think one of the things, you know, is I catch myself, you know, not so much boredom, but when it goes wrong, you know, you overcoach and you feel like you have to find a different way to make something work rather than keep staying with your major, like you said, is changing it just enough. Well, now you're adding something new for the kid. So I caught myself overcoaching a great deal. And, you know, sitting here listening to you just made myself agree with myself even more as I contemplated that, you know, if you're going to major in something and this is what you believe in and you're going to commit to it, you've got to commit to it. Even if it doesn't go right, we got to talk about practice and more reps and keep teaching it up and continue to run it until they run it right or see it the way you want it to be done.
And I love the content, the football content. But I think what Pick said is my favorite thing about this is it transcends many things. I would say life, but here it's a basketball application, or it could be something at home. You know, here we are quarantined. If I want to be good at something at home, everything that you just outlined is true to that also. You know, if I want to be a great father, you know, I mean, it transcends. There's commitment, you know, stick with it.
It is. And that's what is the cool thing about coaching is that it's a fun hobby that thousands of people watch you do, right? And so there's no other hobbies really that get you that. So that is what's fun about coaching. But it is very challenging because thousands of people watch you do it, you're going to be under pressure. And so your ability, and that's where it's cool because you can challenge yourself. There is a level of coaching, and sometimes that levels of coaching isn't about who's a genius. Sometimes it's who can handle some of the stresses of the desires to change, who can handle it better. And that's one of the areas in the game that I've am hoping to continue to improve at. And let's face it, I'm not a head coach right now. Part of it was a huge part was getting my kids the school I wanted in. But another part was I was tired after 11 years of head coach. There was a part of me that was tired of that daily battle of fighting assistant coaches and parents and keeping people happy. And choosing a major is always, no matter what you do, you know, for us, when I first got to Central, it was, we run the ball too much, right? But across town at Centennial, they were under heat because we beat a team in week 7 and we threw the ball for 400 yards on them. The next week they lost to that same team and their fans are mad at them because we threw it on them, right? And they couldn't. And then the following week they were mad at them because they throw too much and all we did was run on this team. So choose your major, because you won't make the people happy. You won't. Right. There will always be someone mad at you. Even if Johnny starts, then Jimmy's parents are mad. And if Jimmy starts, Johnny's parents are mad. You can't win. So those are the things that are tiring about coaching. And that's where, kind of on the Chief Pigskin side, as I'm not head coaching right now, I really kind of feel like I want to encourage guys and say, I get it. This job's hard. Stay encouraged. Stay the course. Someone's got to do it, and we're better if you do it because you're good at this, right? Because if someone's going to do it regardless if you stay in or not. So, you know, I'm hoping to try to encourage some of these guys that are in it, because it's hard.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for being on.
I got just to add a little more. You know, one of the things for me is same thing is, you know, I love being called coach. I think that's one of the, you know, but I allowed it to become what I was rather than, as you called it, a hobby. I let it become who I was, and that stress and all that hard work and everything you talked about, it does. It tires you out and it overwhelms you if you allow it. So same thing for me, I'm off right now. I'd like, you know, I'll see if I come back. But if I do, I've got to understand that it doesn't make who I am. It is a hobby that I'm really good at and enjoy. So I appreciate hearing those from you, as we, you know, so thank you.
It's something that I need to continue to work on as well, because as soon as you're in it, you feel it, you want it, you identify. And I'm learning that lesson. I think currently in this phase of life for me, I'm learning that lesson now is who is Nate Albaugh, and he's not a coach.
Yeah.
It's an important lesson it's important for all of us to have that.
Yeah, that's for sure. And yeah, so I appreciate it. You know, like Ray said, you talk, it's more than football. And that's what, as coaches, you know, that's also what we strive to be, is more than just teaching them how to play the game of football, but also how to be able to manage life and become young men or women, whatever you're coaching, and take these points that we teach them into the real world. So thank you.
You bet.
All right. Conclude the podcast. I do want to say also, Coach Nate, I don't know if you're aware of this, but the last episode you were on had 3 times as many views as any of our other individual episodes. So the people love you. I don't know if you were sharing, or maybe you just have that name or that face that people wanted to see more of or whatever, but we thank you. We might have to have you on periodically and talk life and X's and O's or whatever. But thanks again. This has been another episode of the Gym Teacher Dreams podcast. And you got 10 seconds. What's up with the Chief Pigskin? What do you want to plug?
Hey, we're just staying the course. You know, it's constant. It's every day. We continue to crank things out. If you love coaching, check us out.
All right. Tell a friend. We love you.
All right. Thanks, Coach. We'll see you.